Our first reading is Genesis, the first chapter, and the first several verses of the second chapter. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be a dome in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." So God made the dome and separated the waters that were under the dome from the waters that were above the dome. And it was so. God called the dome sky. And there was evening and there was morning, the second day. And God said, "Let the waters under the sky be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear." And it was so. God called the dry land earth. And the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let the earth put forth vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees of every kind on earth that bear fruit with the seed in it." And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed of every kind, and trees of every kind bearing fruit with the seed in it. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. And God said, "Let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate the day from the night. And let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years. And let there be lights in the dome of the sky to give light on the earth." And it was so. God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night and the stars. And God set them in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, "Let the waters bring forth swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the dome of the sky." So God created the great sea monsters, and every living creature that moves of every kind, with which the waters swarm, and every winged bird of every kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them, saying, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters in the seas, and let the birds multiply on the earth." And there was evening, and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, "Let the earth bring forth living creatures of every kind, cattle and creeping things and wild animals of the earth of every kind." And it was so. God made the wild animals of the earth of every kind, and the cattle of every kind, and everything that creeps upon the ground of every kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, "Let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness. And let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over the wild animals of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth." So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God he created them, male and female, he created them. God blessed them. And God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves upon the earth." God said, "See, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit, and you shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food." And it was so. God saw everything that he had made, and indeed, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all their multitude. And on the seventh day, God finished the work that he had done. And God rested on the seventh day from all the work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on the seventh day God rested from all the work that he had done in creation. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created.
Exodus 23, verses 10 through 12 reads,
For 6 years you shall sow your land and gather in its harvest, but the seventh year you shall let it rest and lie fallow, so that the poor of your people may eat, and what they leave the wild animals may eat. You shall do the same with your vineyard and with your olive orchard. 6 days you shall do your work, but on the seventh day you shall rest, so that your ox and your donkey may have relief, and your home-born slave and resident alien may be refreshed. Do you hear the scope of God's concern in that text? God is concerned with everyone and everything. The Sabbath is intended not only to give us rest and refreshment, but to give relief to livestock and to servants as well. God commands that the fields not be harvested so that the poor people and the wild animals can go out and do the harvesting and thus have food to eat. Even the soil, even the very earth itself, is given a rest, an opportunity to be refreshed. That commandment is repeated in Leviticus 25, verses 1 through 7. The Lord spoke to Moses on Mount Sinai, saying, "Speak to the people of Israel what I say to them. When you enter the land that I am giving you, the land shall observe a Sabbath for the Lord. 6 years you shall sow your field, and 6 years you shall prune your vineyard and gather in their yield. But in the seventh year there shall be a Sabbath of complete rest for the land, a Sabbath for the Lord. You shall not sow your field or prune your vineyard. You shall not reap the aftergrowth of your harvest or gather the grapes of your unpruned vine. It shall be a year of complete rest for the land. You may eat what the land yields during that Sabbath. You, your male and female slaves, your hired and your bound laborers who live with you, your livestock also, and the wild animals in your land. All its yield shall be for their food." This need for rest, this need for refreshment, this need to pause and hit the reset button every now and again, it is woven into the entirety of creation. The Sabbath, according to the Bible, it is for us, it is for human beings, but it is also for animals and for the earth itself. The Sabbath is for all of creation because the Sabbath day arises from God's initial act of creation. Creation is God's gift to us. A world of abundance, a world of beauty and mystery, a life-living and life-sustaining planet with water to drink and air to breathe and fertile soil in which to grow food. A world of forests and prairies, of oceans and mountains, of an unimaginable variety of plants and animals, from the sparrows and the squirrels and the dandelions that I see in my backyard, to tropical rainforests and coral reefs, polar bears. Creation is indeed God's gift to us, but not for us alone. Rather, it is a gift for all people and for all creatures. Sadly, though, throughout our history as a species, we have not always treated the creation and our fellow creatures with the respect that they deserve. We have not always justly shared the earth and its resources with our sisters and brothers in need and in want. Past generations have made both good and bad choices, and we and the rest of creation, we live with the consequences of those choices. One of those choices has been to get the overwhelming majority of our energy from fossil fuels, from coal and oil to natural gas. In many ways, fossil fuels have been a blessing. With energy from fossil fuels, we have created industries and technologies and undreamed of prosperity. to share in this prosperity. And the livelihood of many people are dependent upon the fossil fuel industry. Although for some, like coal miners, it may come at the cost of their health, safety. The use of fossil fuels was probably not the wrong choice for us in the early stages of the industrial era. But as a society, we have clung to that decision in spite of growing evidence that it is not sustainable, that the cost of continuing on this path will eventually outweigh the benefits. Some of these costs are clear and immediate. There have been quite a few news stories recently about trains carrying crude oil exploding, rivers contaminated by ash spills. Other costs are more indirect. The health problems that come from breathing byproducts of burning fossil fuels, the fine carbon particulates, the nitrous oxide, from eating fish contaminated with mercury. And others may be less obvious, but no less real. The increasing amount of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is causing the acidification of our oceans and the disruption of the Earth's climate. These are matters of justice, because these costs fall most heavily on those who are the most vulnerable, like the chronically ill, the elderly. They are disproportionately borne by those who live in poorer countries and in minority communities. As a society, we can debate the advantages and disadvantages of the various alternative energy sources, the various approaches to implementing them, the various costs and benefits of wind and solar and hydro and biofuels, but surely, surely we can and we must demand a cleaner, healthier, safer world for ourselves and for our descendants. Because creation is not God's gift to us alone. It is also for our descendants. It is for our children and for our grandchildren and for generations not yet born. Just as we have to live with the consequences of the decisions that were made by generations that came before us, it will be the generations that follow after us that face the consequences of our choices. We cannot turn back the clock. We may not be able to retrieve and contain all of the toxic chemicals that have been released into the environment. We can't resurrect extinct species. And scientists tell us that at this point it is too late to stop global warming. At best, we can mitigate it. But what we can do as Christians is to obey the Sabbath commandment and give it a rest. Give the soil a rest. Give the earth a rest. Give it a break, an opportunity to refresh and recharge and renew and reinvigorate. In the gospel reading this morning, Jesus instructs his followers to go and proclaim the good news to all nations. That's the term that he uses, all nations. Our Lakota sisters and brothers, they'll tell you that there are more nations on the earth than just the nations of human beings. There is also the horse nation, the buffalo nation, the elk and the turtle and the bird nations. And you might think I'm stretching here, trying to connect this gospel to this idea. But in fact, in Mark's gospel, this idea is made even more explicit. Jesus' final commandment to his disciples, as recounted in Mark's gospel, in Mark 16:15, it says, "Go into all the world and proclaim the good news to the whole creation." Proclaim the good news to the whole creation. You see, not only is the Sabbath commandment for the whole creation, but the good news, the gospel, is also for the whole creation. You are sent from this place to bring good news to people who are hurting and hopeless. Yes, you are. But you are also sent from this place to carry good news to the bee colonies that haven't died off yet. You're called to proclaim good news to the coral reefs that haven't yet been The Sabbath tradition of giving the earth a rest reminds us that we are not independent organisms, but that we are radically interdependent on all the other living things in this world which God has made. We must let go of our sense of superiority, this idea that dominion means take advantage of and not take care of. We have to let go of this sense of superiority and live more humbly as stewards of this creation which God has entrusted to our care. God invites us to turn away from our frantic ways in order to rest, in order to pause, and delight in the goodness and wonder of creation, something that should not be hard for us to do, living in these beautiful black days. Only with such a Sabbath mindset can we find the way which God has set forth